I'd like to introduce our presenter, Celia Bravo-Diaz. She is a PhD candidate in Hispanic linguistics in the Department of Spanish and Portuguese Studies here at the University of Minnesota. And today she is going to be talking about the acquisition of the voicing contrast in L2 Spanish by L1 Chinese speakers, a cross-sectional study. So welcome, Celia.
Thank you so much, Kate, for your introduction. And thank you to all of you for coming to my presentation. Today, I'm going to be presenting a subset of my dissertation data that examines the acquisition of stop consonants by L1 Chinese learners of L2 Spanish in a cross-sectional study. So the first point I wanted to touch upon is the growth of the teaching of Spanish that China has experienced since the second half of the 20th century. And that comes hand in hand with a strong economic and diplomatic relationship between China and Latin America, and also between China and Spain, being China the biggest non-EU trading partner that Spain has. And this trading between China and Spanish-speaking countries has led China to introduce Spanish as a secondary language after English in the higher education, but also recently in 2018 in the system of secondary education. So now students can choose Spanish instead of English to take the national exam to access college. This has led many Spanish universities to create programs that are focused on Chinese learners in Spain, so study abroad programs. So we've seen a really big increase of these programs in Spain in the recent years. And so the goals of my study are to, first of all, to extend our research on the acquisition of L2 Spanish phonology by incorporating students who come from different language backgrounds. Most of the information and the developmental stages that we know of, especially in L2 phonological acquisition, come from data that from L1 English speakers, but we don't know much about speakers who have different L1s apart from English and other Germanic and Romance languages. So these will allow us to further our knowledge of the acquisition of L2 sounds and to evaluate the extent to which these reported patterns of variation and development can be applied to other learners' populations. And then on the other hand, this research that I'm conducting right now wants to include the initial and the most advanced stages of second language acquisition that are absent in much of the literature that we have. And finally, I want to explore the relationship between production and perception of L2 sounds in the same population. So with these overarching goals in mind, I chose the acquisition of Spanish stop consonants, not only because they are the only consonants that occur in every language, but also because they have been reported to be one of the main cues for perceived foreign accent. And also they have been shown in the previous literature to be one of the main areas that L1 Chinese students face as a difficulty when they learn the Spanish sound system. So, although there are many cues to stop consonants, such as F0, formant transitions, and closure duration, VOT, which stands for voice onset time, is the most robust and widely used cue. So this is defined as the interval in milliseconds, so the time between the release of the stop, the release of the burst, and the beginning of voicing. So this results in three categories. We have voicing lead, known as pre-voicing. So when the voicing begins before the release of the burst, so this is voiced Spanish stop consonants in initial position, like gato or bada. Then short lag, so the VOT between 0 and 30 milliseconds. And this is when the voicing just begins shortly after the release. And then finally aspiration or long lag. So when it's above 30 milliseconds. So we can see here the mean values reported in the literature for English, Chinese, and Spanish. So we can see how different, how they substantially differ. So in word initial position, Mandarin would have the longest VOT values, and then followed by English, and finally Spanish. And there is no voicing in Chinese, in Mandarin Chinese, which makes this category especially challenging for Chinese learners of Spanish. And here you can see the same information in a VOT continuum, right? So we have English and then Chinese with the highest values and then Spanish with the negative VOT or pre-voicing. Okay, so then this is even more difficult for L1 Chinese learners of L2 Spanish by the fact that because of the correspondence between graphemes and phonemes in Mandarin, since the grapheme that we see, ba, corresponds in Mandarin to the voiceless bilabial stop in Spanish, so ba. So this has also been reported, although this is not the main focus of this study, it has been reported by the previous literature as being an extra layer of complexity for these speakers. So we have a lot of literature examining the L2 acquisition of Spanish stop consonants. And many, many variables have been looked at. Among them, L2 proficiency. So we have many studies. There is a review by Zambini in 2013 that basically report that as proficiency advances, we see that VOT values for L1 English speakers of learners of L2 Spanish, they get shorter. Although they never reach native-like ranges, they stay in an intermediate level that is shorter than English, but longer than Spanish, at least for voiceless stops. Then study abroad in the extralinguistic variables has been a context that also has been studied in many study abroad programs. Students have been compared to at-home students. And depending on this study, the results have been varied. But for example, in the Atcampos 2016, there was a minimal difference suggesting that study abroad was a context that led to improved pronunciation in comparison to at-home learning context. Time abroad has also been a variable that has been shown to help students reach more native-like VOT levels, as well as explicit instruction. So in the linguistic category, we see style, place of articulation, and following vowel as the factors that have been mostly studied. So place of articulation, the velar consonants have been reported to be the most difficult one to acquire because the VOTs are higher. High vowels have been reported to trigger longer VOT values. And as for style, a more conversational style has been reported to be conductive of longer VOT, shorter VOTs, so more pre-voicing in less formal tasks. So we only have one study, a doctoral dissertation, about L1 Chinese speakers acquiring the system of stop consonants in L2 Spanish, and it was done by Chen in 2007. And the students were 39 learners from Feihua University in Beijing in 4 years of the Spanish program. So the students were not divided into proficiency groups, but they were divided depending on their year of enrollment. There was a one reading task of 72 real words. And the voicing distinction was not acquired by year four, although the year of enrollment was significant. There were two strategies that were used by learners. The first one was neutralization. So some learners mapped the unaspirated plosives of standard Mandarin onto the Spanish plosives, the voiced plosives, and then they pronounced the Spanish voiceless stops with a stronger explosion. And then the second strategy was overcorrection. So some learners, they overemphasized the voicing lead of the voiced plosives in Spanish, and then this led to like a really, sorry. Long pre-voicing. So this study did not include many extra linguistic variables. It also did not find any difference in the strategy used by each learner. As for level of enrollment, they all used these two strategies regardless of level. And it doesn't provide a lot of information on their level of proficiency. As we know, it really varies regardless of year of enrollment. We can find different proficiency levels in the same year. So so these results call for the implementation of more extra-linguistic variables and also for the examination of speakers at more advanced levels of proficiency. So to this end, my study followed the following research questions. So I wanted to know if speakers at different levels of Spanish proficiency, if they produced voiced and voiceless stops with significantly different VOT levels. And if so, in which level did they start differentiating between the three pairs of Spanish stops? Then which independent variables, linguistic and extra-linguistic, affected more the dependent variable, so the relative VOT at each level? And how far are the most proficient speakers from Spanish native speakers in terms of VOT? So my participants are 80 adult learners of Spanish with L1 Chinese who are studying abroad in Spain. So, and then 10 native speakers of Spanish who had Chinese as their L2. So all my participants share the same combination of these two languages, although some of my participants also spoke some dialects and other Chinese languages apart from Mandarin Chinese. So as we can see, all the participants were classified according to their scores in the DELE exam, which distinguishes between six levels of Spanish proficiency according to the Common European Framework of Reference for Languages. So the ones in the level A1 and A2 were the beginners, and then intermediate, and then C1, C2 were advanced. So All the speakers from A1 had been in Spain for 3 months at the time of data collection, A2, 7 months, B1, 6 months, B2, the same, and then C1 and C2, we find variation here. C1, 4.3 years, and then C2, 6 years. So they came from 21 provinces in China, and they were all studying in Spain in different locations. All the students from A1 and A2, B1 and B2, except for two, were based in Toledo. And then the study abroad program that is in Toledo was also the program for B1, B2, A1, A2, B1, B2, and also the former program of C1, C2, because these speakers had years ago been students at this program, but then pursued their master and PhD degrees in other universities in Spain, and then they stayed there, the more advanced speakers. So these students in the study abroad program in Toledo, they fell under two categories. So the A1, A2 speakers, they were first year university students. They had either started university in China and then started a different degree in Spain, and then wanted to start a different degree in Spain, and they had to do this like bridge course to acquire the language skills that the university requires to enter public university in Spain. Or they had not started the university in China, they had not taken the national exam in China, and then they came to Toledo to do 2 semesters of intensive languages instruction to then apply for university in Spain. The B1, B2 were Spanish majors, and then they were either sophomore students or junior students doing their year abroad in Spain. So the materials that I used for the elicitation of stop consonants. So first I did a background questionnaire and a language engagement questionnaire that was an adaptation from the language contact profile from Fried et al. 2004, including the suggestions from the Way et al. 2014. And then after these, I did 3 reading tasks individually with each of the students. Each task was done in a different way in the same week. And the language engagement questionnaire, by the way, in which they had, it was a language log in which they had to indicate how much time they spoke in Spanish and with whom and doing what activities, had also to be completed in the same week. The 3 reading tasks were real words task. There were 60 items. All the stops were in bisyllabic words, a word initially and in a stressed position. And there was a combination of vowels. Then nonsense words, a list of 60 nonsense words. And then short texts that had the same words that the first list of the real words had, but embedded in different dialogues. And the purpose was for students to try to perform the dialogues as naturally as they possibly could, knowing that after the dialogue, I would ask them questions. And the purpose was for them to pay less attention to the form and to elicit a little bit of semi-spontaneous speech from them. They were more focused on the meaning. And this is an example. So in total, there were 183 tokens per participant. And for the data analysis, I conducted an acoustic measurement of VOT. So I'm sure you've seen this before, but this is how the VOT was extracted using PRAD. And then a series of scripts were used to extract the duration of the syllable and of the stop consonant to calculate relative VOT, which was the dependent variable. So then a series of one-way ANOVAs was implemented on the dependent variable, which was relative VOT. And the dependent variables that I looked at were proficiency level, time abroad, Spanish use, place of articulation, vowel, word type, and task. And then a series of post-hoc tests were run. So first of all, this was the data distribution, so 10 tokens had to be removed because of the noise and other non-fricative productions. And so it was a 0.004 of my data, so not really a lot of data, only 6 data points as outliers. So that was the total, 16,460 data points analyzed. So now, as for the results, so I want to start here by showing some general distribution of the VOT. So this simple descriptive statistics, it provides information about the mean VOT, the standard deviation, and the distance from native speakers in milliseconds. So from this, what I want you to pay attention to is what you see framed in red, those are the voiced productions. So what we see is that in these levels, so from A1 to B2, beginner and intermediate, the voiceless stops, they don't differ much from native speakers. They are performing really, really similarly to native speakers, as we see in the native speaker difference in milliseconds. But we do see a clear trend for the three places of articulation for voiced stops, right? So what we see is that they are very far from the native speaker ranges, and they do not produce pre-voicing, at least not consistently, until they reach the B2 level, which is a high intermediate advanced low if we compare it with actual. So what we also see is that as the proficiency level, interestingly, as the proficiency level goes up, the VOT level of voiceless consonants also goes up. This is not statistically significant, but I thought it was interesting. And here we have the same, but with the most advanced learners, so C1 and C2. So we see that the voiceless consonants are are produced with a little bit more VOT. And here we see that the voiced consonants are produced with pre-voicing. So these, the C2 speakers, as we will see afterwards, they're performing in a way that is really, really similar to the native speakers in terms of pre-voicing negative VOT. So after this, what we did is I conducted a series of ANOVAs for each place of articulation. So here we can see that there is a statistically significant difference for VOT. There is an effect for voicing and level, and there's an interaction between level and voicing in each place of articulation, meaning that students at different levels contrast or not contrast between each pair of stop consonants differently. Okay. So from these graphs, so we can see that there is no difference really in place of articulation, as we see the same trend for each one of them. But we do notice that in all three groups, the voiced consonants started to be produced with voicing at around B2, while the groups A1 to B2, they overlap voiced and voiceless consonants. So for this reason, for further analysis, I just put together, I concatenated the places of articulation so that it's a little bit clearer. So this was the result with all the places of articulation together. So for the voiceless chart, we see that the different proficiency levels do not change their levels significantly, although they do have different, so shorter VOTs than the native speakers. And then the voiced, the consonants become closer to native speakers as the level increases. So then I looked at some of the interactions. So first, so place, there isn't an initial effect of place, and we do not see any significant movement toward the native speaker levels in voiced stops until we reach, again, B2. So this happens for all places of articulation. However, what we do see is a very small interaction from the ANOVA, and this comes from the fact that there isn't the same amount of movement for every place of articulation. So in the reason why this doesn't say too much is because the distribution we see for native speakers, where there is a difference in the distribution for each place. So this graph, is similar to the graph that we saw before, but with each place of articulation overlapping each other. So the color is a little hard to see, but the first layer is velar, and then the next layer is dental, and then the third layer is bilabial. So looking at the interaction between level and task, what we find is that there is not a significant effect for task in A1, A2, B1, B2, and native speakers. There was not an interaction, statistically significant effect for word type either. That's why I did not include it. What we see is that there is a large variation for B2. So there is a significant effect for text in C1 and then in C2 levels. So here we have these results illustrated. So what we see is that these speakers are producing more voicing in the task that is less formal or more spontaneous. This starts to happen in B2, although it doesn't reach statistical significance until C1 and C2. There was not a statistically significant result for vowel type. So this is not a factor that is influencing the VOT productions of the speakers, although we see the same trend in voiced consonants. So time abroad was a little tricky to measure because the time abroad in the first four groups coincide with the level of proficiency. So there was nothing that time abroad could tell that level of proficiency couldn't tell. Um, so So I conducted a postdoc test. Sorry. And although the C1 and C2 students had spent different lengths of time in Spain, time abroad did not predict relative VOT in these groups either, as we can see also from this graph. As for Spanish use, so this variable was difficult to measure, and what we find is our results that are a little bit not contradictory, but not 100% reliable, just because the students from A1, A2, B1, B2 spent 5 hours a day in class, and those conversations and exchanges, especially in conversation classes, counted in the language profile in the log, but they were not with native speakers. So this variable might have this fact might have affected the results. But what this chart shows is that this is a test of a simple linear model, and then to see how Spanish use predicts relative VOT at different levels of proficiency. So what we see is that for all groups except for the very beginners, so A1, with more Spanish use, the VOT of voiced stops gets lower. So indicated by the T value. And this is statistically significant for A2, B2, and C2, where VOT levels actually get higher in C2. I do not think this trend would exist with more data points necessarily, since this result could be just driven by the few participants who had much higher Spanish use and comparatively higher VOT values. It should be also noted that their production was already very close to that of native speakers, so there wasn't much room for improvement for these speakers either, regardless of their Spanish use. So here we can see the same trend. So we see how the A2 level and then the B2 levels were the ones that actually were statistically significant for Spanish use. And then the last thing I wanted to mention was that there was a lot of within group variation in the most advanced proficiency levels, as opposed to the A1, A2 levels. So we see that in this case, we find that in B1, they're performing more or less the same way, except for one speaker. But in the B1 and C1 and C2, we see that actually there is a lot of variation. In B2, we find speakers who are producing the voiced stops as voiceless stops with positive VOT values, and those who are mostly producing them with negative VOT levels. This changes a little bit in C1, where only half of the speakers show this trend, only 8, and only 1 in C2. But we do find these two different profiles. So to show you just an example of how it sounds like, this is an example of goma produced by a B2 learner in the text activity. You can.
Goma. Goma.
With a voiceless pronunciation. And this would be an example of a C2 learner or speaker who still is producing who is producing, is overgeneralizing the VOT, the negative VOT, and producing voiceless stops with pre-voicing. And this is an example of the word velo.
Velo.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so going back to the research questions. So the first research question, do the learners at different levels produce voiced and voiceless stops with significantly different VOT values? And in which level do they start differentiating between P and B, T and B, and K and J? G, sorry. So L1 Chinese learners of Spanish do show development, so movement toward target-like norms in the production of initial voiced stops, since the voiced stops were already very, very similar to the ones produced by native speakers. The learners at the beginner and low intermediate level, so A1 to B1, do not differentiate voiced and voiceless stops in any place, and they seem to be mapping the unaspirated stops in Chinese directly into Spanish voiceless stops, since they both have similar VOTs. So category formation seems to start at around B2. And this is in opposition to other results by, for example, the study by Gonzalez and Consulman 2013. Although these students in this study who did show category formation evidence at the beginner stages had already had previous exposure to Spanish for 3 years before this study, although they were placed at the beginner Spanish class at the university, they already had previous experience with the language, unlike students in my study. And when they reach the advanced level, so C1, C2, they consistently produce voiced plosives with negative VOTs and voiceless stops with positive VOTs, except for one speaker in C2, who is producing both to a great extent with negative VOTs. So if we go to the next section of this question, we have to look more into individual patterns, because we do have a significant group-wide patterns, but there are individual trends and there are a lot of variation at the intermediate and advanced levels. And the overcorrection strategy found by Chen in 2007, so learners adding along pre-voicing at the beginning of the voiced plosives, it appears in the B2 level and it disappears in the C2 level, except for one speaker. And then this is what, okay. And then the second research question, so which independent variable significantly affect the dependent variable, so relative VOT at each level of proficiency, and are there interactions between these variables? So level of proficiency, as we've already seen, does significantly affect VOT levels of voiced stops. Task has a difference in VOT, but only in text, and is only significant for C1 and C2. So when they are, it seems that when they are not paying that much attention to the form, their VOT values for voiced stops become closer to native speakers. There's not a significant effect for place of articulation, vowel type. Time abroad does not affect VOT levels of the most advanced speakers. And as for Spanish use, we should further examine the nature and the quality of the linguistic interactions that the speakers report, self-reported to reach more conclusive conclusions. And then as for the last research questions, how far the most proficient learners, so C2 level, from the VOT values of the Spanish native speakers. So we see that VOT levels produced by C1 speakers are very similar to native speakers, although they do differ in some ways. For example, C2 speakers produce longer VOT for the voiced consonants during text task, and this has no effect in native speaker group. And in this coincides with the results from other studies. In comparison to Chen 2017, there is much more development between levels, and there the results from the B2 levels are already more similar to what we would expect from a native speaker, and these might point to an effect of the context of immersion in study abroad that might allow the students to improve more in their pronunciation of voiced segments. And this is just a graph showing how similar the native speakers and the most advanced speakers are behaving in terms of relative VOT with voiced consonants for the three places of articulation. So the next steps the first step is to analyze the perception data. The second step would be to incorporate their VOT values for their native language Chinese and also their second language English to compare them with the values shown for Spanish. As for the perception data, this data could provide more information about the process of category formation and if it is perceptually driven during the early stages of adult L2 development, like has been shown in other studies, and if an accurate perception is something necessary that leads to accurate production. So with this, I'm going to finish, and I would be really happy to take any questions or comments that you might have.
Thank you, Celia. So we have the chat open if you want to use that for questions, or if you'd prefer to ask a question orally, just go ahead and use the raise hand feature. I can get the ball rolling. Oh, sorry. Yeah, Lily. Lily has a question.
Yes. Hi. My name is Lily, and thank you so much, Celia, for your presentation. So I might have more questions as I come up, but for right now, I have one that I'm like curious to know. I think in the results sections, you mentioned that there's like a significant variance for B2 groups in their correlation with the level and the task, if I'm remembering it correctly. So I guess with that in mind, my question is, why would it be like B2, who is the group that would have like more significant variance versus I think like in my mind, I would either think like either like very like beginner speakers or like advanced speaker might have like the variance, like a larger variance.
So the larger variance, their performance started to get more consolidated as the level went up. I think this might be because of the different contacts with Spanish that these speakers had. So as their level went up, they practiced Spanish and they to different extents, right? So the A1 and A2 speakers, they did not have much interaction with the native community of native speakers of Spanish in Toledo, because their level proficiency did not really allow them to participate in functional conversations in Spanish. So their Spanish exposure was really limited to the 5 hours a day, 6 days a week that they had classes. So I think as the level went up, so when they reached B2, they started making more connections with the community and just practicing Spanish to different degrees. So I think that's why it's in B2 where we see more variance, although the task type did not affect significantly until C1, C2. We start seeing the trend in B2, but it doesn't show as a significant variable until C1, the text type.
Oh, okay. Okay, that makes sense. Thank you.
You're very welcome. Thank you for your question.
I have a quick question. So I was curious at the beginning of your talk, Celia, when you said that, consonant voicing is a problem area for people who are acquiring Spanish. And it's true in French too, especially in word final position. Especially for Anglophones, they tend not to to release final consonants to an adequate degree to be able to make the distinction between masculine and feminine, for instance, or singular and plural. So I was just curious if, given that this is a phenomenon across languages that can affect potentially speakers of different languages differently, I wondered if maybe you have thought about your data in relation to Spanish learners of English or Spanish or English learners of Spanish or learners of Spanish who speak other first L1s, I guess is my question. Does that make sense?
That's a really good question. And I think that, I think the reason why these segments are really difficult for the L2 speakers, and I am assuming, well, I already kind of know because I already have the perception data, but I think they're more difficult for them to produce than to perceive, is because of the articulatory gesture that we need when we produce these sounds, that is just difficult to produce because you have to tense your organs and in a certain way that if you don't have those sounds in your native tongue, then it just requires more articulatory effort, like rhotics, for example, like vibrants. And I think from what I've read in the literature that it affects speakers from other languages that do not have voicing, that do not have pre-voicing in the voiced stop consonants. Something that relates to your question that I thought it was very interesting when I was analyzing the data. So when I was analyzing the language background of the speakers, I found that many speakers that come from Shanghai, Jiangsu, all these provinces where other Wu languages are spoken apart from Mandarin Chinese, they knew this dialect and they spoke this dialect at home. And this dialect has pre-voicing. It has a three voicing contrast like Korean. So I specifically analyzed if that pre-voicing in the L1, or I don't know if I should call it L1, but they all had some knowledge of this Wu language or dialect, if that had an effect, and it didn't. So they were not transferring that pre-voicing that they had in these dialects or second languages, home languages, to Spanish, which I thought it was very interesting. And I don't have an explanation for that, but yeah.
Thanks, Celia. Any other questions for Celia?
I have a question. Hi, Celia. Good job. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay. So my question is about how these individuals were, or when these individuals, these participants were assigned that score from the Sapphire scale, that A1 through C2. Do you know at what point were they given that evaluation? Was it recent prior to when you were able to analyze the data, or was it several months ago, or did it vary?
Yeah, so the good question, thank you. Yeah, so I forgot to mention that, but the way I recruited students in the program, in the study abroad program, so A1, A2, B1, B2, had been placed by the study abroad program using that exam in that semester. So meaning that B1 students had passed the B1 Vele exam, and the same for all the speakers. As for C1 and C2, they had to show me that they had passed the test to participate in this study, but all of them had passed that exam in the year, the except for one C1 student who took it in April. So I collected his data in March, and then he passed the exam in April. Except for that one, all of them had passed that exam in the 3 months, 4 months prior to the data collection. So that's what I, because it was, I collected other data apart from this data. So I just wanted to reduce the amount of time that I was taking from them. So I thought that would be the best way to do it, instead of administering a proficiency exam myself.
Thank you.
You're very welcome. Thank you. Wendy.
Thanks, Celia. Oh, sorry, Kate. Do we have time?
No.
So it was really fun to start seeing some of your results coming in. And it seems to me like your participants end up presenting almost two different profiles, right? Mm-hmm. Where you have your learners kind of in that B1 to 2 that start to distinguish the voiced and the voiceless stops. And then you have learners though that don't. Mm-hmm. Is that accurate? Am I like remembering the date? Okay. So I'm curious, but it also seems like, you know, when you looked at kind of the background variables, the individual learner variables with respect to their use of Spanish, that was just really messy data and no trends could be discerned there. So I'm curious if you could just maybe like what your thoughts are about why we see these different profiles with respect to how they're producing and separating out these two, the sounds, the voiceless and the voiced sound stop consonants.
So I think that is a question that I also have, and I have to look more into. I wonder if individual differences that I have not measured and that I do not have a way to measure right now, like for example motivation, have played a role into that. Because it's true that we see that difference, and they're like two really clear profiles, especially for B2 and C1. So I don't know if those variables or maybe the way I'm measuring language contact and language use should be done differently so that it could explain that. Maybe I will divide, like I will measure the level of contact with or practice Spanish with native speakers of Spanish instead of just Spanish. And I think that might throw more information about that.
It's just a really interesting trend, right? It's really interesting to see that and think about how this correlates to the different proficiency levels, right? Kind of what's the relationship between how somebody pronounces the sounds and kind of their level of comprehensibility and overall general proficiency. So it was just interesting to see within this group the variability that exists. And I think it really speaks to the importance of looking at the individual learner and not just group trends.
Yeah, exactly. And I think maybe if I have time to analyze the 25, the data collection, the second one, because I have a little bit of a longitudinal data, So it's like 5 months apart, 4 or 5 months apart. I think that might also give me some information, because I will see how the A1, A2, B1 and B2 speakers developed these patterns 4 months later. I don't know if 4 months will be enough time, but from the data I have, it seems like it will probably, because the B1 and B2 students were only 1 year apart in terms of time studying Spanish. So I think that data might give us some more information about that.
Thanks. Sounds like a good follow-up study to your dissertation, Celia. Looking at the longitudinal data. Yeah.
The plan was that I was going to, or I'm going to analyze that, those 25 students, because I only could collect data from 25 students. The rest of the students didn't want to do another round of data collection after the first one, but those 25 did. So I have that data that I'm gonna analyze.
Well, we wish you luck as you move forward with your data analysis. Thanks so much for sharing these findings with us. And thanks to everybody for coming today. We know that you have lots of options for talks and professional development. So we really appreciate that you chose to come to a Carla talk and to hear about Celia's project. We hope that we'll see you again at another point this semester. And I wish everybody a great end of the day. Take good care.
Thank you, Kate. And thank you for coming.